Hi, very good morning. I'm Dr. Janak Patel, MD, General Physician. Today we'll be discussing on one of the very interesting topic we call thoracic outlet syndrome. All my video lectures are mainly for educative purpose. In continuity with the series, today we'll be discussing on thoracic outlet syndrome. This group of people you might come across in your everyday practice. It may be asked in your theory or in your oral exams. And good number of time you will have to differentiate from many other conditions which mimics identical like thoracic outlet syndrome. It's a person who comes with pain in upper limb. You will have to differentiate brachialgia from thoracic outlet syndrome. So we'll be discussing under some headings like definition, etiology, pathophysiology, clinical features, investigations, differential diagnosis, treatment and complications. Now, thoracic outlet syndrome is a group of symptoms and signs which is due to abnormal compression of neurovascular bundle either by bony material like cervical rib or ligament or muscle in the narrow space between clavicle and first rib, which we call as thoracic outlet. And depending upon which portion of neurovascular bundle is compressed, we put them into nervous or arterial or venous thoracic outlet. So short we call is NTOS, that is nerve compression, A for arterial, V for venous. So this will be the three groups of people who will come to you, or you can have mixture of the two. So basically it is a group of symptoms and signs which is due to compression of neurovascular bundle by various structures between first rib and clavicle. And that space is called thoracic outlet. So we call neurogenic type, which is almost 95% of the time. Venous is 3-4%, and arterial is only 1-2%. So most common is neurogenic, second common is venous, and third is arterial. So in interscalenus triangle, that is in scalenus anterior, or it is also called as a scalenus anticus syndrome, where mainly artery and nerve which is passing through between the two bundle, or we call scalenus triangle, interscalene triangle, artery and nerve is going, so you can get arterial compression or a nerve compression. While in a costoclavicular space, that is also called as a Eden syndrome, where only vein is passing through, so chance of that is very, very likely. Also, you can have associated with artery and nerve. While in a subcoracoid area, or we call pectoralis minor area, you can have all the three structures, artery, vein and nerve, where again nerve is more commonly involved. Second common is vein and third is artery. And it is also labeled as hyperabduction syndrome. This is quite common in accidental injuries. So we come across venous variety from subclavian vein compression, neurogenic variety, which is compression of the brachial plexus, and arterial from subclavian artery compression. So these are the three structures. So depending upon where you get compression accordingly, we'll be showing you all those. So you can get compression in a scalenus triangle where you get compression of the nerve or artery, because those two structures are passing through that. At costoclavicular space, medialmost will be vein. So very commonly you get a venous subclavian vein compression, and then in this particular space, scalenus triangle, artery and nerve is passing through, So in that costoclavicular space will include both scalenus triangle as well as the triangle which is between anterior tendon of scalenus anticus and clavicle and first rib. While at pectoralis minor space, you will have mainly compression of all the three structures, but more of neurogenic. Second common is venous, third is arterial. And we have already mentioned before that 95% of the time is neurogenic, 3% is venous, and 1% is arterial. So this is first rib. This is a triangle we call scalene triangle. You can see that the brachial plexus and subclavian artery is passing through. While in a costoclavicular space, that is, this is first rib and this is clavicle. So medially, vein, these are the two tendons of scalenus anticus, between that brachial plexus and artery. So here you can have compression of all the three structures. But more common is vein, which will get compressed much earlier, while these two will be in case of scalenus anticus triangle. And at pectoralis minor, all the three are coming out. That is brachial plexus, artery and vein. All the three structures are coming out. So in that area, you can get compression of brachial plexus, subclavian artery and subclavian vein. Any one of those can be compressed. But most common is brachial plexus. Second common is vein and third common is artery. So in cervical rib syndrome, because of cervical rib that can compress at artery more common than other structures. So you will get clavicle rib compressing the blood vessel and that will produce obstruction of the artery. While scalenus anticus syndrome will compress artery and nerve both. But more of nerve, second common will be artery. While costoclavicular will compress costoclavicular, that will be between clavicle and first rib, that will compress vessel and nerves. But more of nerves, mainly among vessel, vein will be more common. Second common will be nerve, third common will be artery. While in pectoralis minor, hyperabduction syndrome, it is called also hyperabduction syndrome, well, it will compress any one of these three. First common will be brachial plexus, second common is artery, and then vein. So these are the four common syndromes which we'll be seeing. Cervical rib, scalenus anticus, hyperabduction, and costoclavicular. So these are the three common syndromes which we come across in our everyday practice at thoracic outlet. According to the new classification, it is divided into uncomplicated and complicated. And complicated is also called true thoracic outlet syndrome. While uncomplicated is usually called as a non-specific or common or disputed. And in that uncomplicated, predominant neurogenic, predominant arterial, or predominant venous. So these are the three common words which are being utilized. Etiology-wise, cervical rib is very, very common. Second common may be because of long transverse process of cervical spine, vertebra. Abnormal insertion of a scalenus anticus muscle. Or there may be hypertrophy of scalenus, hypertrophy, muscle hypertrophy. Or there is some abnormality in scalenus minimus. Or there may be abnormal bands or ligaments. Occasionally it may be because of fracture clavicle or fracture of first rib. Or there may be abnormal projection of exostosis or maybe tumor. Or because of traumatic injury, particularly hyperabduction of shoulder. Some of the common injury we call whiplash injury, quite common. Another common is repetitive activity, particularly in athletes, heavyweight lifters, etc. And another very common is because of accessory cervical rib, which may be long enough to compress the structures. And also we have mentioned in a clavicular fixation in fracture clavicle. or maybe because of abnormal tendon or abnormal ligaments, bands, etc. So the most common is traumatic injury. Second common is tumor, which can produce compression. And third common, presence of cervical rib. And in that, the arterial compression is quite common. So either because of skeletal or bone abnormality, soft tissue abnormality, and because of poor posture, particularly hyperabduction, that are the three common mechanisms. So tumor, trauma, and poor posture becomes the common causes. And among trauma, whiplash injury is very, very common in roadside accidental injury. As far as repetitive activity is concerned, particularly the person who is typing on a computer, athletes, swimmers, baseball player, or even in the person who are heavy lifters. It is also common in obesity and during pregnancy. Cervical rib becomes one of the most common. So this is, you can see bilateral cervical rib. This rib is more longer than this side. So this side, chances of cervical compression will be more. So depending upon which side it is producing compression, you will get symptoms and signs. So you can different types of abnormality in the spine also, or we call vertebra, where you can have complete bony deformity or complete fibrous or combined. This is complete bony. This is fibrous. Or you can have bony plus fibrous. Or you can have a bony swelling. Different types of abnormal projection from vertebra can be there. In neurogenic, the most common etiology is whiplash injury. Second is repetitive stress injury. These two comes topmost on the list. And you can have once in a while, because of scalenus anticus muscle abnormality or narrow triangle or congenital ligaments and bands. And one another cause of neurogenic is cervical rib. So whiplash injury comes topmost on the list. That is because of hyperextension neck injury, we call. As far as venous is concerned, very frequently because of anomaly of costoclavicular space and repetitive arm activity, particularly in a baseball player, swimming, person who is doing a lifting works, throwing works, etc. So because of that repetitive activity, you can get injury too. First common injury is to the vein, subclavian vein. Then second common will be cervical plexus or brachial plexus. Among arterial, mainly because of anomalous of first rib or anomalous insertion of an anterior scalenus insertion. So these two will be the common pathophysiology. As far as incidence is concerned, incidence is 1 to 2%. Age most common is between 20 to 50. Female are more prone as compared to male. Neurogenic is almost in 95%. Venous is in 4% and arterial is only 1%. If we go through the anatomy and pathophysiology, you have to first understand there are three areas where you can get compression. We have got a better diagram to show you. I'll show to the other diagrams. Yes, this is a better one. Now you can see that here, this is clavicle, this is first rib, this is costoclavicular, this is rib, costoclavicular area. So in a costoclavicular space, you can have subclavian vein, this is scalenus anticus, and between the scalenus anticus two tendon, you will have a passing of brachial plexus and subclavian artery. And below the pectoralis minor, that is the third outlet. So this is scalenus anticus triangle. This is costoclavicular space, where you have got both subclavian vein as well as subclavian artery and brachial plexus passing through that area. But between the two muscle and tendon, that is scalenus anticus, anterior scalenus muscle or scalenus anticus muscle to tendon, that is we call as a triangle, where two structures are only passing, that is subclavian artery and brachial plexus. So that is passing through, then all the three structure together passes below the pectoralis. This is pectoralis muscle. So pectoralis minor. So that will be the another area where you can get compression. So these are the three area: scalenus anticus triangle, costoclavicular space, and pectoralis minor space. So these are the three area. Here two structures, subclavian artery and brachial plexus. Here between these two, brachial plexus and subclavian artery. Here subclavian vein. Medial two, anterior tendon of scalenus anticus. And this is below the pectoralis minor. Below the pectoralis minor, all the three structures. That is brachial plexus, subclavian artery, and subclavian vein, all the three structures. So those are the three, and this is from the top, what we call as the thoracic space. So this is subclavian artery, subclavian vein, brachial plexus, how it comes out. So this is vein, costoclavicular ligament, this is anterior tendon, this is triangle where two subclavian artery and brachial plexus is coming out. This is also called costoclavicular space. So this is costo and this is clavicle. So that space will include both. This anterior space and this is triangular space. This is also called scalenus anticus triangle. And below the pectoralis minor, this is that triangle. Two structures are coming out. And from anterior to that anterior tendon, anterior scalenus muscle, and this is middle scalenus muscle, you get a triangle. But anterior to that, and this is subclavius muscle, and you can see here there is a ligament also, costoclavicular ligament. So this, from this area, only one structure which comes out is subclavian vein. Then all the three structures will pass through another thoracic outlet below the pectoralis minor. This is pectoralis minor. And below that all the three structures comes out. It is also called as pectoralis minor space or subcoracoid space or subcoracoid area. Subcoracoid area. We already mentioned this. Now, cervical rib comes topmost on the list. Another common is scalenus anticus or medius muscle triangle where you can get compression. Then first rib abnormality. Then long transverse process of vertebra, particularly C7 vertebra. Or you can get compression because of hyperabduction of pectoralis minor muscle. Or you can have because of compression by costocoracoid ligaments, costoclavicular membranes. Then clavicle abnormality like fracture clavicle, etc. And we already mentioned 95% of the time it is nerve in which you can get peripheral nerve compression which will produce paresthesia, pain, that is neuralgic pain. Or if it is for a long period, you can start getting motor weakness. If it compresses the sympathetic fibers, then you can have Raynaud's phenomena. You can have pain, color, temperature changes, ischemia, and trophic changes. This will be quite common if you get sympathetic fiber getting damaged. In case of venous, vascular, particularly vein, you will have edema, then you will have a venous distension, and then you start getting changes in the skin, etc. That is described as a Paget scrotal syndrome. And because of the compression of the subclavian artery, you will have claudication pain, loss of pulse, claudication pain, and you can have thrombus formation in an artery. Then later on, you can start developing ischemic pain and then gangrene. So this will be, in general, in short, the pathophysiology as well as clinical picture. Neurogenic, where you can have a somatic nerve getting involved, sympathetic fiber getting involved. In subclavian artery, you can have loss of pulse, claudication, thrombosis, and finally, it can end up with ischemia, trophic changes, and gangrene. While in a subclavian vein, edema, venous distension, and there is one syndrome which is being described, Paget Scrotter syndrome. Neurogenic is most common, almost 95% of time. It is because of compression of the brachial plexus, leading to pain in the neck region, tingling numbness, to a severe neuralgia. And later on, person can have muscle wasting because of motor fiber getting involved. So weakness, wasting, or we call atrophy, and you can even see fasciculation. So that will be very, very typical in case of neurogenic. And it is because of compression of a brachial plexus. Most common compression is in a triangle, scalenus anticus triangle. That is most common. And second component is hyperabduction syndrome, which can occur below the pectoralis minor, or we call subcoracoid space. And in that, you get sensory loss or paresthesia. Initially, you get paresthesia, followed by sensory loss, that is hypoesthesia to anesthesia. Or sometimes you can get pain in the neck region and also pain in the arm, which will be neuralgic pain. Because of motor nerve compression, you will get muscular atrophy. You will get fasciculation. You can see atrophy part. And that atrophy of the hand muscles is described as gliat, summer hand, sumner hand. It is described as that. In subclavianoid compression, person will present with a Raynaud's phenomena, may present as a Raynaud's phenomena because of two mechanisms. One, because of subclavian artery compression, and one, because of the sympathetic system damage. You can have pallor, coldness, Raynaud's phenomena. Even the pulse may be diminished to absent. And you can demonstrate some of the signs, will be showing you some of those signs. And person can have claudications. So these are some of the symptoms what you can come across. We'll be showing you in further slides. So person can complain of pain and fatigue. Pulse will be diminished to absent. There will be fall of blood pressure by more than 20 millimeter of mercury in an affected arm as compared to the opposite arm. You will have a pain, pallor, paresthesia. Even person will complain of Raynaud's phenomena along with that. And if there is a mark diminished in the perfusion, you can have even cold extremities. And later on, even gangrene. As far as venous is concerned, pain, sinuses, and swelling is quite common. We'll be showing you that particular. So swelling will be quite common because of venous edema. Vein will be distended, so you will have a dilated veins, venous distension. Generalized pain in the arm, not like claudication, but sometimes we describe as a venous claudication. And you will have risk of thrombosis in the arm. And that is given a name, Paget Scrotter disease. And person will also complain of heaviness. And you can develop venous gangrene. Now the side where there is a compression, you will have a depressed shoulder. And you will have either compression of the nerve is most common. And second common compression you can come across is venous. Third is artery. But arterial compression will be more common with scalenus anticus triangle compression in that area and because of cervical rib, because these two diseases are very, very common. So interscalene triangle will compress artery and nerve. We call scalenus anticus syndrome. In costoclavicular space, if you come across vein is more compressed, it is Iden syndrome. And in a subcoracoid area, or we call pectoralis minor syndrome, where all the three can be compressed, we call hyperabduction syndrome. So primary symptoms, mainly paresthesia, or root pains, weakness. Person might have occipital or frontal headache. Then person might have pain in the anterior deltoid region, breast pain. Or person might have pain also in the facial, auricular or dental region or TM joints, pain. Person can have a sensory blunting and secondary symptom in the form of brachial ischemia, fatigue, venous engorgement, vasospasm, vasoconstriction, etc. Means all the three groups are being involved. So nerve, artery and vein, all the three are being involved. In a neurogenic, which we have already mentioned, paresthesia, neuralgic pain, followed by muscular weakness, atrophy, quite common. Particularly, this is more common with scalenus anticus syndrome, as well as cervical rib also can produce those symptoms, and in hyperabduction, these three will be common. So, extension of the shoulder, neck will be painful. Upper plexus disorder or lower plexus damage, depending upon upper plexus, you will have C5, C6, C7 involved, and lower plexus C8 and T1 will be involved. You can have occipital headache in upper plexus, muscular weakness, atrophy, vasomotor symptom in the form of vasospasm, edema, hypersensitivity, Raynaud's phenomena may be also seen in neurogenic groups. Neurogenic is also common in pectoralis minor because of hyperabduction. So in that condition, you will have pain over the anterior part of the chest and axillary region. And sometimes you can have pain in a neck and head region. In arterial, we already mentioned weak pulse, cold extremities, upper limb claudication, and you might start developing thrombosis, and later on you can end up with gangrene. And in an arterial, you can have Raynaud's phenomena also, and you can end up with gangrene. Venous compression will very frequently lead to edema, which is very, very common. Dilated veins or collateral veins, superficial vein distension, cyanosis, and there is a syndrome which is being described as a Paget scrotal syndrome, where you get thrombus formation, and because of venous thrombosis, repetitive activity, secondary due to repetitive activity, uncommon deep vein thrombosis due to repetitive activity of upper limb, that can happen in case of venous compression. Almost we have described. So this is venous symptoms, this is arterial symptoms. At your leisure time, you can go through, almost it is repeated. Now I am going to all the different types of tests. These are the tests to reproduce the compression of different material, that is brachial plexus, artery, vein, etc. due to thoracic outlet syndrome. First is called hands up test. So when you do a hands up, this is the usual posture which we acquire, or it is also called as Roux test. In that, the patient opens and closes his hands repeatedly with this position, acquiring this position. And while doing that test, person will produce pain, heaviness or arm weakness within first minutes after beginning. So this is called positive Roux test or hands up test. Means you have to elevate the arm, put it in this position and then do flexion, means closer and opening of close and open the fist. That will be the things what will be done. And if the person gets occurrence of pain, heaviness and even weakness, that will be, or you can rotate the arm. That will be the another movement. Here there is a rotation which is being done. Here opening and closing of the fist. So that is Roux test. Sensitivity is almost 84%. Specificity is between 30 to 100%. So positive test, person will complain of pain, paresthesia, and he'll discontinue the test and he'll drop the arm to get relief. This is very, very good test. Three names are there: hands up test, Roux test, and also they got elevate arm stress test. Elevate arm stress test or EAST. These are the three names which are being utilized. There is one test called Edson test or Scalene test or Wright test. These are the three names where patient will rotate his head towards the tested arm while examiner will extend the arm. So at shoulder joint and at elbow, you extend the arm. You are palpating the radial pulse. You are extending the arm and person is rotating the head towards the tested arm. In this particular, because of neck's rotation and head tilting, the person will get elicitation of pain, paresthesia. And this will be one of the tests also described as upper limb tension test. And you will have slowly the radial pulse will be weaker or may even be absent. Another way of eliciting the test is ask the person to take and hold the deep breath, extend the neck fully and turn the face to one side. And when he is doing that, the anterior and middle scalenus muscle is contracting and you will have diminution in pulse and radial pulse may be absent also. That suggests compression of radial, that is subclavian artery in scalenus triangle. In scalenus triangle. Sometime this test will be also positive in case of cervical rib. You will be able to demonstrate this in a cervical rib. It is called Edson test or Wright test or Scalene test. These are the three common names which are being utilized. Three names. And also there is one more name called upper limb tension test, in which instead of these particular movements, here you are doing extension and rotation of head. Here you have done extension and flexion here and you are looking for radial pulse and rotation of head or tilting of head. While in this, the two arms are extended laterally, abducted and extended. Elbow is extended and you have done abduction at shoulder joint. So that is position one. And then you do dorsiflexion at wrist. When you are doing this particular test, if the person starts getting pain, it will be positive. And then you can tilt the head to one side, tilt the head to the side, on one side. So head is turned contralaterally. The arm is abducted with the elbow extension. And if you get pain, that will be sensitive, 90% sensitivity is there. There is one more test called as a costoclavicular maneuver, Helstedt costoclavicular maneuver. These are all multiple tests, mainly done by an orthopedic person, where you are doing abduction and extension of the arm with downward pressure on the shoulder and neck. Turn to opposite side will reproduce the symptom, and that is very common with compression at clavicle and first rib. We call costoclavicular space getting compressed, and this is also very common when you exaggerate the military position. So this is also called costoclavicular test, Eden test, drooping test or military position. That is particularly for costoclavicular area compression. So Eden test, military brace. This is Wright test where you are doing abduction at shoulder, flexion at elbow, and then you are tilting the head to the opposite side or rotating the head to the opposite side and you are looking for the radial pulse. So that is called Wright test and this is called Eden test or you call drooping test, where you are doing extension at shoulder or we call hyperextension at shoulder, hyperextension and abduction, little abduction and hyperextension. These are all provocative. This is a military position and when you do the exaggerated military position, it will be there. You can demonstrate Tinel sign and Fennel sign if there is a compression at carpal tunnel. So that will be important. Claudication test. Shoulder is drawn backward and upward. The arm is raised horizontally with elbow flexed to 90 degree. And with exercise of the hand, pain and numbness indicates that there is a compression of a subclavian artery, and that is called claudication test. There is hyperabduction test. Arm is hyperabducted to 180 degree like this. You will have diminished in radial pulse, or even radial pulse may become absent, and you might get even compression in a subcoracoid region by pectoralis minor tendon and head of humerus or coracoid process. So this is a very common mode of damage to those two structures, that is brachial plexus and second compression of the subclavian artery. So that will be quite common, particularly in a roadside accidental injury, whiplash injury, hyperabduction syndrome, etc. So these are the hyperabduction, what is being done. And you will have diminished radial pulse, and person might have even complained of brachial plexus. So these are also labeled as Wright's hyperabduction test. Allen test is mainly done for radial artery and median artery circulation. There is something called the cervical rotation lateral flexion test, where patient is in a sitting posture. Examiner passively rotates the head away from the affected side, then gently flexes and the neck forward to end the range of movements ear towards the ventral part of the chest. Very odd way, but when you do that, when you are doing a forward flexion, the person complains of pain, notably decreases with a hard end feel. So this is very good test to find out the compression of neurovascular bundle. There is one more test called lidocaine scalene block. So under a computer guided or ultrasound guided, you inject a local anesthetic in anterior scalenus muscle, and then following that injection, now person gets relief of symptoms. It is 90% predictable. 90% predictable. And this relief will remain for 4 hours, almost up to 4 hours. Then this can be utilized for relief of symptoms also. The list of investigation will include X-ray chest, cervical spine X-ray. Now in an X-ray chest, mainly we look for the cervical rib, accessory cervical rib, and in a cervical spine we look at the spikes or any transverse process abnormality. Ultrasonography and colored Doppler is very frequently utilized to look for the arterial circulation and venous circulation. You can go for MRI and cervical myelography to find out the amount of compression. Then we call as MRI angio or MRI venography to find out venous and arterial involvement. And for nerve conduction study and EMG for finding out the nerve involvement and amount of muscle damage, motor muscle damage, we call electrodiagnostic test. This will be very, very important in thoracic outlet syndrome. So for nerve damage, electrodiagnostic test like EMG and nerve conduction study. Also, you can go for even we call as MRI. Usually for arterial and venous, we call Doppler duplex ultrasound. Or you can go for CT or MRI. Or you can go combination of CT MRI with arteriography or venography to find out the initiation of thrombus formation and occlusion. Plain X-ray for spine, shoulder, collarbones, and even to find out the cervical ribs. And any other investigation which is required to come to the nearmost diagnosis. So this is no conduction study. These are different types of MRI, etc. done. This is again EMG. This is no conduction. You can go for EMG to find out the amount, number of or severity of muscle involvement. This is duplex, arterial duplex. This is venous duplex. This is arteriography. This is venography. This is again arteriography showing you the compression here. And here you can see the compression in arteriography. Here you can see the compression in a venography. You can identify also in a venous Doppler duplex and arterial duplex the obstruction severity, how much is the obstruction. This is venography. This is provocative venography. So you can go for duplex sonography. You can go for MRI, plain X-ray, which will show you cervical rib, any abnormality in the transverse process, etc. So cervical rib, you can identify cervical rib producing compression. You can identify that cervical rib. Or you can also sometime identify abnormal transverse process. So these are all the different types of CT. This is CT, this is MRI, which will help you to identify different pathophysiology. This is again MRI, different MRI. This is MRI 3D techniques. You can look for thoracic outlets. This is dynamic phlebography. In differential diagnosis, there will be a lot of different skeletomuscular problems, acromial clavicular joint involvement, brachial plexus injury, cervical disc, cervical discogenic pain syndrome, cervical radiculopathy, clavicular injury, elbow forearm overuse injury, shoulder impingement syndromes, thoracic disc injury, thoracic discogenic pain syndromes. Means musculoskeletal disorders will be a lot of conditions which can produce similar type of pain. It will be more of neurogenic rather than arterial or venous. So lot of differential diagnosis, right from multiple sclerosis, rotator cuff injury, cervical rib anomaly, spinal cord tumors, carpal tunnel syndrome, cubital tunnel syndromes, all those can be a differential diagnosis. As far as treatment part is concerned, one is symptomatic. You can go for what we call as decompression or surgical intervention. So by and large, you require symptomatic treatment in the form of analgesic like non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. In a mild symptom, mainly physiotherapy will help a lot. Even in an obese individual, weight reduction will be helpful. If person has got an acute vascular injury or progressive neurological dysfunction, and if the conservative treatment does not give the results, then you should go for decompression surgery, means surgical intervention. These are the different types of physiotherapy. You can go for non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. And in a person who is developing thrombus in artery or vein, you can go for thrombolysis. So thrombolysis can be utilized in a particularly very useful in venous thrombosis. Usually in artery, we rarely get thrombus formation, but still in that also it will be useful. So in a mild symptoms, pain medication and physiotherapy, while surgical intervention, that is surgical resection, particularly in a progressive neurological dysfunction or acute vascular injury. So in a mild case, physiotherapy, weight reduction, NSAID, thrombolysis will be required only if there is a venous thrombosis. So you can give continued anticoagulation, thrombolysis followed by anticoagulants, and surgical intervention where you might require cervical rib resection or decompressions. So transaxillary resection of cervical rib or first rib, or you might require, in case of a artery or vein involvement, angioplasty or venous or arterial bypass, etc., of a narrowed vessel. That may be the alternative. These are the algorithm you can go at least. So medical treatment, analgesic, anti-inflammatory, muscle relaxant, weight reduction, physiotherapy, most important. And surgical intervention is decompression therapy. Non-operative treatment, we already mentioned. Physiotherapy will be very, very helpful. But it should be proper physiotherapy. It should not exaggerate the symptoms and signs. So it should be done by an expert. In surgical treatment, we have, in general, we use the word decompression. So depend upon where is the compression accordingly. So decompression can be done. This is decompression indicated in which conditions. And you can go for splenectomy, first rib resection. Then you can even go for complete removal plus splenectomy, etc. As far as complication is concerned, right from neurological complication, arterial thrombosis, thromboembolism, post-aortic aneurysm formation, venous thrombosis, these are quite common. So this will be the most common. So nerve injury, vascular injury, thoracic duct injury, and pleural complication may be there while doing surgical interventions. Recurrent nerve is quite common because of post-operative scarring, quite common. So you must have a regular follow-up. So I end my lecture here. Thank you all for taking out time. I know that your time is valuable and I appreciate that you have spent some of the time with me. Once in a while you will come across a person with thoracic outlet syndrome, which will be a very, very common differential diagnosis for brachial neuralgia. So proper examination will help you out. And earlier you make a diagnosis, you will be able to give him a good relief. If you like this particular lecture, please don't forget to press button like. Press bell icon so you get a message for next video lecture. And if you feel that this will be helpful to your friend, you can share with your friends. And don't forget to subscribe. See you in next lecture.